It really is a privilege to be with you today. My very first time on Gabriel Island, although I've lived in Canada for almost 32 years and now living in Victoria. And I kind of feel at home among you guys this morning because several things have been mentioned today that have rung bells with me. You're having Jeffrey Thudian here next week, and I've just been with his parents in India. I was down there for nearly a month between January and February for ministry. And then you're having Steve Thiessen the week after that. And I have the privilege of teaching in the Cape and Ray Bible School from time to time. And I knew Steve through that. So these guys are dear friends. So I kind of feel part of what's going on here. Do you know what I mean? So it's a privilege to be with you. And thank you for the invitation. The other thing that was mentioned that rang bells was Maple Ridge. My older son lives there with 8 of our 10 grandchildren and his wife, of course. So we know Maple Ridge as well. So there you go. Yes, so I'm born and raised in Scotland, as you can hear. Then my wife and I, after I was in Bible school, we got married and we moved to the south of England. And we were involved in evangelism there. And in the summer months, we were traveling around East Sussex with a tent and a trailer, doing outreach ministry in villages and small towns, and then preaching the gospel in various churches in the winter months. And then in 1984, we came to Canada, and we're based in Victoria. We have a ministry called Evangelism International, and it sounds very grand, you know, but it just means it's me and my wife. and we have a board of directors, of course, as you have to do these days. But we're so thankful to the Lord for his goodness over all these years. I've been married to the same woman for 51 years, and just thank God for her every day. If it hadn't been for her, I wouldn't have been able to do half of what we've been doing over the years. So we've so much to thank God for, do we not? And to be grateful every day, and we rejoice in the Lord's goodness. Another couple of things just to mention quickly, and I've written a couple of books over the recent years. One is called, the first one, So Why Do I Need the Bible? And I wrote this book because I kept meeting Christians who go from one Sunday to the next and never ever open God's Word. They're like you, brother. They think you just read it on certain days, you know. But anyway, that was one of the reasons I wrote this book, to help people either discover or rediscover the Word of God. And then the second one, the other great malaise among God's people is the disease of church hopping. You know, people that you meet, you can't preach the same sermon in every church these days because you get the same congregation sometimes. But this one is called, So Why Do I Need a Church? And God's been blessing these two books. So if you are interested, I brought a few with me. This one is $10. This one is $15. If you buy them both, you get them for $20. And that's got to be a good deal coming from a Scotsman. So there you go. And I've got some of our little prayer cards as well if you're interested to know more about our ministry. So there we go. You've got time now to get used to the accent. So we'll turn to the Word of God, shall we? And we're going to read this morning in the book of Philippians and chapter 3. Philippians and chapter 3. And I've just been quite excited this morning and as we've been worshiping the Lord because some of the songs that we've sung today, believe it or not, as I've been preparing this message for today, these songs have been going through my mind. Take the world, but give me Jesus. All its joys are but a name. Praise the Lord. I just love that because it's kind of confirmation that we're all moving under the leading of the Holy Spirit. And that's really good. So Philippians chapter 3, and we're going to read from verse number 7. Philippians 3 from verse number 7. Paul, and I'm reading from the New American Standard Bible, by the way. But whatever things, Paul says, but whatever things were gained to me, those things I have counted as loss for the sake of Christ. More than that, I count all things to be loss in view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and count them but rubbish, so that I may gain Christ, and may be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own derived from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which comes from God on the basis of faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformed to his death, in order that I might attain to the resurrection of the dead. Not that I have already obtained it, or have already become perfect, but I press on, so that I may lay hold of that for which Christ also, I was laid hold of by Christ Jesus. Brethren, I do not regard myself as having laid hold of it yet, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and reaching forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Let us therefore, as many as are perfect, have this attitude, and if in anything you have a different attitude, God will reveal that also to you. However, let us keep living by the same standard to which we have attained. We'll stop there, and we'll trust God to bless his word to us today. Now, the letter to Philippians, you may know, is the one that's called the letter of joy. And that's quite significant when you consider that Paul was writing the letter while he was in prison. Not the kind of situation you would think as being joyful. But there he was in that situation, and he writes this letter, and he encourages them more than once to rejoice in the Lord. That's evidence, I think, of the reality of his relationship with the Lord Jesus. Evidence of the reality of it. It's not just a religious thing. Christ was obviously very real to Paul when he wrote these words. And so when you're going through difficulties and challenges, and at the same time you can rejoice in the Lord, there is something significant going on in your experience. And I'm trusting today that as we look at this, we'll see something more of what that really means. So when you take an overall picture of this letter to Philippians, one thing that comes very clear as you study it is that it's a letter that is totally Christ-centered. In every chapter, we read more and more about the Lord Jesus. In chapter 1, for example, Paul talks about Christ as being our life. Christ as being our life. And he says down at verse number 21, the key verse to the chapter, to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. To me to live is, he didn't say to me it's to live for Christ. He says to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain, because Christ is his very life. And then if that's true in a person's experience, you come into the second chapter, and you find that that affects your attitude. It affects your thinking about everything, if Christ is your life. So he says in chapter 2, verse 5, the key verse, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Or let this attitude be in you. When you know Jesus as your Savior, and you know him personally, you know him as your life, your attitude to everything changes. You may recall in Romans 12, Paul said there that he beseeches us, by the mercies of Christ, that we present our bodies wholly acceptable to the Lord, which is our reasonable service, he says. And he says, then the next thing he says is, don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Now, when he says that, notice the order, present your bodies as a living sacrifice to the Lord, wholly acceptable to him. When we surrender everything to Christ as Lord, and let me say this, ladies and gentlemen, nothing, the Christian experience will not work until we get there. Until we're prepared to surrender everything to Christ as Lord, allowing him to be number one in our lives, then only then will what he teaches us become reality for us. Because when we surrender to Christ, Romans 12 again, the very first thing that happens is our attitude to everything is changed. We're renewed by the renewing of our mind. Everything changes. We think differently about everything. Then, of course, you come into the third chapter of Philippians that we've read from this morning. When Christ is my life and my attitude to everything has been changed, I have a new focus in my life. I have a new goal for living. And so the key verse is one that we read this morning, that I might know him and the power of his resurrection, the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformed to his death. And then we go into the last chapter, chapter 4, and we find there that Paul talks about all kinds of circumstances, and he's saying, doesn't matter what the circumstances are, no matter what is going on in my life, he says, the key verse is verse number 13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. He is my strength. So he's my life, he's my mind, he's my goal, he's my strength. In other words, everything I need I can find in the Lord Jesus. These are incredible truths, ladies and gentlemen, and I'm praying this morning that they will become infinitely more real for us as the Lord teaches us from his word. But I want to home in right now on one of those verses in chapter 3 that we read together, and that is the key verse of chapter 3, that I might know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death. Now, before Paul wrote these words, you remember, if you read the first verses of the third chapter, you'll find he gives us an abbreviated version of his testimony. And he tells us of the kind of man he was before he met Christ. And he was a unique and a wonderfully gifted individual. He had breeding, he had education, he had all kinds of things going for him. And yet he comes to the fact when he says, since I met Christ, meeting the Lord Jesus has transformed everything in my life and in my experience. And he's saying to us, he's saying, no matter what it was, position, wealth, education, whatever you might think about, all of these things are but rubbish compared to knowing Christ. Now that's quite a statement to make. It demonstrates what a transforming effect meeting Jesus had on Paul's life. Not only this, but he doesn't tell us this bit here, but if you read his testimony in Acts of the Apostles, you find there that Paul was a man, when we meet him first, he was filled with hatred and bitterness, resentment and anger and murder. He was all out for, he was a first century ISIS member. The only thing you could think about then was destroying believers. That was what consumed the man. He was filled with utter evil and hatred. And yet he met the risen Christ, and everything changed. Hallelujah. Everything changed. He saw Jesus for himself. He came face to face with the risen Lord Jesus. And so he tells us, whatever things were gained to me, these I have counted loss for the sake of Christ. He says, I count all things to be loss in view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. And friends, today let me just say this to you. When Paul talks about that and he goes on from there, he's not just talking about one past experience. I mean, I can remember, for example, the 15th of March, 1949, when I was 6.5 years of age. You're all sitting there doing the math now. I'm 73, just to save you the bother, so that you keep listening to me. But on the 15th of March, 1949, I can remember being on my knees with my dad or receiving Christ as my Savior. I can remember that as if it were yesterday. It was very real. But thank God it doesn't stop there. Amen? Yes. If it did, I question very much whether I would be standing here today. God had a lot more to do in my life, that's for sure, and he still has. But I'm here today by the grace of God and nothing else. And we give him all the praise and the glory, do we not? It's all due to his wonderful grace and mercy. But you see, what I'm trying to say to you, my dear friends, is this. Being a Christian is not just looking back on a date when you trusted Christ. Being a believer in Jesus means going on and on, growing every day in the knowledge of him. Paul said this was the consuming passion of his life, that I might know him. That's all that matters to this man now, that I might know him. And it was the consuming passion of his life. Now, People, this, let's take this a bit at a time, shall we? What were we talking about when we talk about that I may know him? You might say, well, I've known Jesus for a long time. Do you know him better today than you did last Sunday? Do you know him better today than you did a year ago? That's kind of the test. Do you know what I'm saying? Do I really know him? Am I getting to know him more better every day? Now, when the Old Testament prophet Jeremiah wrote these words many, many years ago in chapter 9 of his prophecy, where he said, thus says the Lord, let not the wise man boast in his wisdom, let not the mighty man boast in his might, let not the rich man boast in his riches, but let him who boasts boast in this, that he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord who exercises loving kindness and justice and righteousness on earth, for I delight in these things, declares the Lord. This is the thing the prophet says to boast in, that he understands and knows me. Now, that's quite a mouthful, folks, if you think about it. We're not talking about just head knowledge, just that he understands and knows me. We're talking here about the one who is the Lord, Jehovah, the Creator, the one who is from everlasting to everlasting, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Infinite One, that he understands and knows me. That is an amazing thing. But the wonder of it all is this, that God is actually inviting us to enter into that kind of growing and developing knowledge of him, understanding and knowing him. Now, how do we ever come to understand God? He is beyond our understanding, really. Amen? All of eternity will not be enough to understand God fully. But praise God, listen to me, dear friends. If you're a Christian today, you have in your hands this morning the most priceless of all gifts. You have the inspired, infallible, inerrant Word of God. From Genesis to Revelation, every word of it inspired by the Holy Spirit. This is an amazing thing. And as you and I are men and women who are spending time soaking ourselves in the truth of God's Word, taking time every day to meditate in the Word, allowing the Spirit of God to teach us, coming with humility, Lord, teach me today, as Paul prayed for the Ephesians, that God would grant them a spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of God. My late father-in-law, who was a wonderful man of God, he used to talk about revealed truth. You know, you could listen to preachers till you're blue in the face, but there is no substitute for being in the Word of God and the Holy Spirit revealing the truth of God's Word to your heart. It becomes your own then, you see. It's not secondhand. It's yours. The Holy Spirit has revealed it. And when the Spirit of God is revealing truth to your heart, then you're growing in the knowledge of Him. It's an experiential knowledge of the Lord. And that is very important. So Paul comes, and this man had great intellect. He had amazing. He was an amazing individual. But he came to this moment in his life, this point in his experience, where all of that, compared to what we're talking about now, all of that meant nothing. You don't learn this stuff merely intellectually. Now, I'm not decrying intellect. Please don't misunderstand me. God gave you brains to use them, okay? So that's important. But what I am saying to you today is when it comes to knowing the Lord individually and experientially, it comes through His revealed truth to our minds and our hearts, getting from here to here. The longest journey in the world, somebody says. You know, have you ever had the experience? I remember, just let me illustrate for you here. You read a verse of Scripture hundreds of times. And then all of a sudden, one day, you read it again, and you're thinking about it, and it hits you like it never hit you before. And all the lights go on in a whole new way. I was down in Mexico 2 or 3 years ago for ministry there, and I was staying in a little cottage on my own. And I was walking up and down in prayer, and I like to do that. My thoughts wander if I'm on my knees for too long. So I would wander up and down and pray and talk to the Lord and read the Word and pray. And I remember I was reading 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 16 to 18. It says this, it's one of the most ridiculous things you'll ever read. Rejoice evermore. What a stupid thing to say. Come on, let's get real. Rejoice always? You've got to be kidding, eh? Rejoice always? Pray without ceasing? And in everything give thanks? That's ridiculous. When you think of what the kind of week you've just had, maybe, rejoice always. And then it hit me. If I know Jesus, I have a choice to make. Amen?
Amen.
I have a choice. I can choose either to let it all overwhelm me, become all depressed and miserable, and whine and complain, or I can decide right now I'm going to rejoice in the Lord. Because He is my life. Amen? What does that mean, dear friends? What does it mean, Christ? What does that mean that He is my life? It means He literally lives on the inside of me by the Holy Spirit. He doesn't give me life. When you read the fruit of the Spirit, for example, you know, fruit, it's not stuck onto a tree. You know, it grows out of the tree, right? We've got an apple tree right outside our dining room window where I live in Victoria. And right now the blossom is just opening up. And unless something's happened that's drastic, you know, but as happens every year that we've lived there, this flowers drop away and these little apples appear. And before you know, there's a crop of fruit. Amen? When the Bible says, talks about the fruit of the Spirit, it's saying exactly the same thing. The only reason there will be fruit there is because there's life there. And the only reason there's life there is because Jesus lives there. It's His life. And when we allow Him to live His life through us, that's when the fruit comes. Amen? Get excited about it. Isn't it amazing? It's absolutely amazing. The life of Jesus, He is my very life. And living through me, He reproduces His life. The fruit of the Spirit is love, His love. Joy, His joy. Peace, His peace. Long-suffering, His long-suffering. Patience, kindness, and so we go on. It's all His through me, praise His name. And when I get to this stage of acknowledging that if I lived till I was 1,000, there's no way in the world I could produce that kind of fruit on my own, by mere effort. I just say, Lord, bless Your wonderful name. You live in me. Live through me today. Amen? Have Your way, Lord. So Paul's saying to us, he's saying that I may know Him. This is what he means. And he goes on to say that I may know Him and the power of His resurrection. The power of His resurrection. Last weekend, we were celebrating Easter. What a glorious thing that is. Amen? Glorious thing. And it struck me all over again when I was thinking about today, and another week's gone by. We're celebrating the fact that the Lord rose from the dead. But if, as the Scripture says, He is risen, that means He's still alive. Amen? It's not just a historical event, although it is that. But it means He's still alive. He will never die again. He lives in the power of an indissoluble life, the Bible tells us. Death could have no claim upon Jesus. Praise His name. I feel another sermon coming on right now, but I'm not going to go there. He's still alive. He is risen. He is risen. And right now, praise his name. This life that Paul's talking about, you see, we talk about the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. What is eternal life? It is his life, amen? It's his life. And so when Christ lives in me, that's what eternal life means. It's his life in me. So Paul's saying that I might know him and the power of his resurrection. I'm going to say something to you today when I heard what was going on among you, dear people, and I know that this past week has been a very difficult one for you as a fellowship. I understand that. I feel I can talk to you from my heart right now. Because my wife, who's the best thing that ever happened to me, apart from knowing Jesus, has suffered from depression. Now listen to me, people. When I'm talking about depression, my wife gave me permission to say this. I found a suicide note twice. Now, you can't say to somebody like that, snap out of it. That is not possible. Depression is an illness. It's not linked in any way to a person's walk with the Lord. You with me? It's an illness. It's like having the flu or pneumonia or something. It is a physical illness. Sometimes it's a chemical imbalance in the brain. All that kind of thing. I know what that's all about. It is unbelievable for the person suffering. And it's very bad for the people looking on. It's heart-wrenching. It's heartbreaking. And I have prayed, my wife, bless her heart, it's a long story. But I've prayed hundreds of times that the Lord would heal her. She's not so bad as she used to be. When we came to Canada, we discovered she was very badly hypoglycemic. She came off sugar. She was a different woman within a week. It's amazing. Amazing. So it doesn't happen nearly so often now. We praise God for that. We're so grateful to the Lord. But what I wanted to tell you, I was out for a walk. I try to walk every day if I can. And I was out my walk the other morning, and I was crying out to the Lord. I'm saying, Lord, it would be just wonderful if Isabel was completely healed. I don't know how many millions of times I've prayed that. And then the thought came to me, 2 Corinthians chapter 12. Paul had a thorn in the flesh, you know? And he prayed just 3 times that the Lord would take it away. The Lord said, no. He said, I'll tell you what, Paul, my grace is sufficient for you, and my strength is made perfect in weakness. And the thought hit me right there and then that if this goes on forever and ever, hallelujah, his grace is sufficient. And right there in my walk again, Lord, I choose to praise the Lord. I choose to rejoice in the Lord. Hallelujah. My dear friend, today, when it gets hard, and it does sometimes, really hard, praise the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Just do it. Praise the Lord. Because you see, when we do that, we're allowing the Spirit of God to have his way in our hearts and in our lives. That is the evidence of the power of his resurrection. That is the reality of resurrection life, do you see? That's resurrection life. that I have been crucified with Christ. Hallelujah. Nevertheless, I live, yet it's not me who lives, but Christ lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. It's not me who lives, it's Christ who lives in me. And when you and I are going through these black times in our lives and we choose to praise the Lord, we're not being flippant. I'm not suggesting you go on some glory session just to impress everybody how spiritual you are, because we're not in the least bit impressed, believe me. We're not making an exhibition of ourselves at all. Thank God we can dance, we can praise him. You ever feel like jumping up and down for the glory of God? You've never lived if you've never been there. Just to praise him. But it's not about just an empty glory session. It's about from the depths of your soul, from the depths of your being, I choose to praise the Lord. Because he is my life. He lives in me. And it's resurrection life. It's resurrection life. That I may know him and the power of his resurrection. The same power that raised Jesus from the dead. And when that event happened, my friends, everything to do with sin was conquered forever. Hallelujah. The victory was complete. The devil was destroyed, rendered powerless. Hallelujah. Now, I'm preaching that right now. I'll probably be tested in that before this day is out. But you know what? I want to say this to you. The circumstances don't alter resurrection life in the believer. And as we choose to praise the Lord, we are knowing the power of his resurrection. But friends, just quickly, when you're knowing the power of his resurrection and you're living the kind of quality life that that brings, you will also inevitably know the fellowship of his sufferings. You'll know what that means. It is becoming increasingly challenging in 2016 to live a godly life in this world. Jesus told us, if they hate me, they'll hate you. If they persecute me, they'll persecute you. So don't be surprised. It's almost inevitable. The world, you know, man, we live, people meet every day, they're just blind. My wife and I were yesterday, we were invited by two dear friends that we have who are Jewish, a Jewish couple. And we went to an event in Victoria where the local rabbi was showing us a very ancient, magnificent copy of the Torah. And we had a lecture on that. It was very interesting. But that dear man was absolutely clueless as to resurrection life. It was so sad, so obvious. Do you know what I'm saying? People, the devil has blinded the minds of unbelievers. And no matter who they are, oh, how we need to love them. How we need to just say, Jesus, live your resurrection life through me. But there will be the fellowship of his sufferings. But being made conformable, as Paul says, to his death. Recognizing I'm crucified with Christ. I'm dead to this world. Amen. I'm dead to sin. That's what God has done in your life, my brother, my sister. That's what God says of you and me today. I'm not making this up. This is God's word to you today. You have been crucified with Christ. And as Paul says in Romans 6, therefore, reckon yourselves dead to sin. Stop complaining about your sin. Stop getting browbeaten by the devil of your constant faults and failings. I've got thousands of them. You just ask my wife sometime. You know what I mean? They're all there. We all know ourselves too well. Amen? We just do. But the Bible says, look, consider yourself dead to that rubbish. It's gone. It went to the cross. Hallelujah. Now I live, but it's not me who lives now. It's Jesus who lives in me. The life I now live, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. So Paul says, therefore, and I'll just finish with this. He goes on later in the chapter, he says, one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind. This is one of those other ridiculous bits in the Bible. How can you possibly forget what lies behind? Come on. You're thinking about it right now, aren't you? I mean, you are. You're just thinking about it right now. How can you do that? I mean, it's ridiculous. No, it's not. Because it's all under the blood of Calvary, amen? That's why you can remember it, but rejoice that it's not dominating your life anymore. Rejoice it's been dealt with. As some of you might have heard me tell this story, those of you have heard me speak before, but I just love it. I was watching a National Geographic movie one time, and it was all about the great white shark. And they were studying, and these guys got down in this big cage, and they were filming these great white sharks, and then they got found a baby one, and it was all tied up with fishermen's cords, you know, ropes and stuff, and complete bondage. So they managed to get this young shark into shallow water, and then a couple of the guys got into the water beside it, and then they cut the ropes off it, and then it just lay there for a while. Then all of a sudden, it was as though it dawned on it, the rope was gone, out into the ocean. Now my little mind went like this. When that kid found his mom and dad again, he'd be saying, hey guys, you never guess what happened to me. You never guess what happened to me. A little while ago I was bound up with all these ropes, and this guy got down beside me and he cut the ropes and I'm free. He remembered the ropes, but he concentrates now on what? The freedom. Amen? That's what Paul means when he says forgetting those things which are behind. Okay? We think about, we know that we're there, but praise God, we concentrate now on the fact that we're free. May God be glorified, dear brothers and sisters, today. As you and I, we go from this place this morning with this new focus, that I might know him. Oh, Lord, that I might know you. Nothing, nothing, nothing else in this world matters quite like that. We're going to remember the Lord together right now. And I just want to say this. I'm going to read a couple of scriptures. And I just want to say this. When you look into this new week, all of us are probably going to do some pretty significant things, things that are significant in our lives. I just want to humbly remind you, my brothers and sisters, you will not do anything this week more significant than what we're going to do right now. When we take bread and wine and we remember Jesus, we're coming right back to the cross, amen? We're coming right back to where it all happened, the central pivotal point in all of history, when the Son of God died in our place on that cross. He was buried. He rose again the third day, according to the Scriptures. And we rejoice in him today. And we're going to remember him just right now. But I want to read a couple of Scriptures just to prepare our hearts. The first one's in Matthew chapter 26. And as I think of the sad things that have been happening to you as a fellowship in recent days, I just feel that some of these words take on special meaning. In Matthew chapter 12, there's a quote there from Isaiah 42. And it talks about the Lord Jesus, that a bruised reed he will not break, a dimly burning wick, he will not snuff out. Jesus comes to Paul's family today with tremendous compassion. What happened to Paul has nothing to do with his walk with Jesus. It's the result of a sickness. The Lord has taken him home. And we can be thankful for that today. Amen. It's very real. And we come to a Savior who understands in amazing ways. And in the prophecy of Isaiah, that wonderful 53rd chapter, the prophet says, among many other things, he has borne our griefs. He has carried our sorrows. Isn't that wonderful? He's carried our sorrows, borne our griefs. That's what Jesus was doing when he went to the cross. And so Jesus himself says in Matthew 26, says, while they were eating, Jesus took some bread, and after blessing, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, and he said, take, eat, this is my body. When he had taken a cup and given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you, for this is my body of the covenant, which is poured out for many for forgiveness of sins. Isn't that a beautiful thing? We're going to take bread and wine this morning, and we're going to remember the Lord. And we take this bread, it's a symbol of the broken body of the Lord Jesus, the one who bore our sins in his body on the cross, bore our sorrows, carried our pain. We're going to take that bread, and we're going to remember him. Lord, we just worship you together. We bless you for all that you've done for us. We marvel at the fact that the Son of God bore our sins in his body on the cross. We rejoice in forgiveness. We rejoice in newness of life, resurrection life. And we give you all the praise. Amen.